If you just go over that mountain over there, there's a 20-man camp, and every square inch of ground between the end of the Peel watershed and Mayo has been staked for gold.
Mining versus migration. What's the future of nearly two dozen caribou herds as gold fever spreads through the Yukon? A spectacular river gorge, a critical migration path, and a unique cultural heritage could get some new safeguards in northern New Mexico. The current U.S. drought is the worst since the Dust Bowl of the 1930s. Are renewable energy projects the answer to these hot, dry times?
Their scales are covered with a kind of an iridescent sheen that, in the right light, just is brilliant.
The eastern indigo snake is elusive and endangered. Those stories and more now on This American Land. Funding for This American Land provided by the Weiss Foundation and the Turner Foundation.
Hello and welcome to This American Land. I'm Caroline Revelle.
And I'm Bruce Burkhart. A spectacular gorge in northern New Mexico is a flyway for migratory birds, and it cuts right through an important habitat for elk and deer. It's also an area where Hispanic culture, with its hunting and fishing, grazing and gathering, has thrived for hundreds of years.
Congress is considering a bill to protect it as the Rio Grande del Norte National Conservation Area. Gary Stryker has our story.
It has a violent volcanic past, built by explosions, lava flows, and a great cleavage in the Earth's crust. After millions of years, it is still a forbidding land, but with very special attractions.
The geologic beauty, the unique opportunity for solitude, the silence of the canyon, and the spiritual aspect of the culture and the people that live here make this a very unique area that's been that way for many, many generations.
Nice piece of pottery right at the base of the ash deposit.
Humans have been drawn here in northern New Mexico for millennia.
Within the landscape the site is located in, we found artifacts that probably date as early as 10,000 years.
And today, it still commands fascination and awe from those who stop to explore it and from those who live here.
You come here and you find calm.
Esther Garcia is the mayor of the nearby village of Cuesta. Her family has farmed here for 11 generations.
You can just sit here for hours and just look at the clouds, look at the mountains, look at the river, and it's just beautiful.
Esther's family shares history with many Hispanic descendants in this area. A history of rough frontier life with few luxuries and endless hard labor.
This is rugged country, a dry sagebrush plateau between huge volcanic cinder cones. But the Rio Grande runs right through it, and that is what attracted Spanish settlers here from the south about 200 years ago.
In this arid high desert, the river made it possible to irrigate farmland and water livestock. The Rio Grande in this deep gorge is still a mountain river, young and fast, headed south to mark the international border with Mexico for hundreds of miles. The gorge itself is a spectacular tourist attraction, plunging 800 feet to the river below, and a whitewater river run known as the Box, a major asset for tourist-related businesses here, like Cisco Guevara's.
Tourism is a very important economic part of the New Mexico economy. So the more we protect the water and the land that the rafting happens in, the better you're protecting the economy.
Protecting this wild and dramatic landscape is considered so important by many that there's a bill in Congress to protect much of it, including the River Gorge Corridor, two mountain wilderness areas, and a high plateau between them. Altogether, some 236,000 acres that would form the Rio Grande del Norte National Conservation Area, a measure wildlife advocates strongly support.
You know, you're looking at the diversity of ecosystems and what lies in the Rio Grande del Norte that offers itself to calving grounds for migratory elk herds and deer herds. And now there's actually a good population of bighorn sheep in the Rio Grande corridor. From a wildlife standpoint, there's just so many different species out there.
For countless migratory birds, the gorge is a critical part of the north-south Rio Grande migratory flyway. Its cliffs offering key nesting sites for raptors like golden eagles and red-tailed hawks.
Neotropical migratory songbirds in the spring. You'll just see the banks lined with western tanagers or Wilson warblers or white-crowned sparrows. And there's just a freeway of birds midair traveling back and forth. So it's a really, really magnificent wildlife area.
I think you fished this already, dude.
God.
Yeah.
And then there's the fishing up against wild trout and pike.
Everybody talks about what trout fishing must have been like 100 years ago. Well, here at the Rio Grande, you can still have that.
And it's really untouched by the hand of man.
Beyond the river gorge, the conservation area would also protect vital migratory habitat for elk and antelope on the Taos Plateau. And on its east and west, two key wilderness areas on iconic landforms, Mount San Antonio and Ute Mountain. At more than 10,000 feet and roadless, Ute Mountain is an island of undisturbed forested highlands and a vital habitat for the region's large mammals. Claire Cote and her firefighter husband, Chris, live off the grid in the shadow of Ute Mountain.
Ute Mountain is unique because it's a standalone mountain in the middle of vast prairie and elk and bear and all kinds of wildlife use it as a sanctuary.
And then you have the gorge almost adjacent to it that creates even a richer habitat.
Establishing the conservation area and wilderness would prohibit any future development, including oil and gas exploration, but would allow local traditional uses of the area to continue.
The grazing, the fishing, the hunting, the herb gathering, all of that to us should be preserved. That's part of our culture and our history.
That's a big reason why most of those who live here are strong supporters of the proposed law.
There's a philosophy in northern New Mexico that goes this way. You can take my wife or take my husband, but don't touch my land, my water, or my grazing traditions.
There was a lot of questions that were being asked. And I think once some of those questions were answered, people were fine with it as long as we had some input into the bill that was going to be proposed.
Supporters also include Native Americans in the nearby Taos Pueblo, who were instrumental in reintroducing bighorn sheep to the river corridor.
It's important because a lot of the species that live in that corridor come in and out. If that easement isn't there, we won't have much animals that the Indian people depend on as food and clothing and shelter.
It seems almost everyone here backs the bill in Congress. And there seems to be one worry that unites just about everyone on the Rio Grande del Norte.
If this thing starts to get mined and logged and subdivisions built all over it, it's going to lose that special quality. And everybody's of the same mind because we are of the land and water. Protecting it protects our lives, protects our livelihoods.
There's a 21st century gold rush going full force in Canada right now, but mining in the remote and pristine Peel watershed could have an impact on wildlife on both sides of the border. A battle is brewing over the future of this ecosystem.
There's no word that I can use to describe this country because of it's beautiful. I would say incredibly beautiful.
Jimmy Johnny has spent 50 years hunting and fishing in the Peel River watershed, one of the largest and most pristine ecosystems on the planet. Just 100 miles from the Alaska border in the Yukon Territory of Canada, this vast primeval wilderness is under threat. Today, he's pushing the Canadian government to protect the peel forever.
It's the water. That's my main focus of protection. That's where you survive. That's what keeps you alive. It really does.
The Peel's nearly 26,000 square miles of wild rivers, arboreal forests, and mountain ranges contain a wealth of biological treasures. But treasure of a different kind is jeopardizing the future of this massive wilderness.
This has been the largest year for mining in the Yukon in history. So over $150 million spent on just exploration alone. This is the Peel watershed here. And in the areas just south of the Peel watershed, there's this massive modern-day gold rush.
If you just go over that mountain over there, there's a 20-man camp, and every square inch of ground between the end of the Peel watershed and Mayo has been staked for gold.
The reason that we need to protect it is that there are intact, healthy populations of animals that are threatened in places further south. So we have grizzlies, we have wolverine, we have peregrine falcon, we have wolves, and of course we have caribou.
22 separate caribou herds can be found here in the Yukon. The largest, the porcupine herd, 120,000 animals that annually migrate an epic 3,000 miles to give birth in Alaska's Arctic National Wildlife Refuge. In the winter, the porcupine caribou forage in the shallow snows of Canada's Peel River watershed. Their fate and the fate of the watershed are intertwined.
The herd is international, and what happens on one side of the border affects what happens on the other side of the border. And this is one of the few herds that actually does have an international agreement that was signed in 1987 between Canada and the U.S.
Along with gold fever comes industrial development. Mining the mineral-rich Yukon leaves behind a legacy of environmental impacts.
About 2 or 3 kilometer long airstrips. You have line cutting for surveying. You have trenching, so they have to dig many, many cubic meters up to see what's down underneath. You have drilling and drill pads. You have a tremendous amount of air traffic, helicopters and airplanes. You have camps.
So we're quite concerned about the herd in the sense that anything that would disrupt or increase mortality rates might have an effect on the ability to increase. It's only increasing at 4% a year.
It's not only the caribou population that is of concern, but also the many diverse Arctic and subarctic species in both Alaska and Canada that depend on them for survival. Environmentalists believe protecting large, untouched tracts of land, such as the Peel watershed, are key, not only to caribou, but the planet as a whole.
What is a hedge against the uncertainty of the future? And I believe that we've got to leave as much of nature intact as possible, because that is the source of our well-being.
The more we encroach on nature and in wilderness areas, the less integrity that ecosystem has, and you start to degrade bits and pieces of it and increase access and move herds and affect different animals' natural life. You degrade the whole system.
For Jimmy Johnny, who has spent a lifetime living in and off this wild landscape, industry has its place. It's just not welcome here.
Tell you the truth, I'm not against mining altogether, but up in this area, I'm against it, yes.
A Canadian commission has recommended protection of 80% of the Peel watershed from industrial development. But the Yukon government has rejected that recommendation as too restrictive, and that has many here gearing up for a long fight.
July 2012. The hottest month in the continental U.S. since the government started keeping records 117 years ago. The severe drought that's hit farmers and ranchers has been devastating to crops and livestock. But in some areas, people who depend on the land are using renewable energy to prepare for the prolonged dry times. The drought in eastern New Mexico has hit farmers and ranchers hard.
We've had a drought before, but I don't remember a time being like this.
Only a few ranchers have any cattle left on their land.
The biggest majority of us had to sell their cattle herd. That also affects their future income in the future years.
Bob Frost now has only 4 steers in this corral, all that's left after he sold more than 300 head late last year. Without any grass on his ranch, he couldn't afford to feed them.
If I had to
put every bite into them that they grow on. I just can't do it.
Like most landowners here, the Frost have weathered droughts before. Five generations of their family have ranched this land.
This used to be grass.
Yeah.
But this drought is breaking records. You can see it in the bare fields and dead trees, and especially in the dry canals and sand-filled ditches that should be irrigating this land.
Normally this time of year, we'd have about 10 foot of water in this canal. Out of the past 12 years, five of those years we've had no water. The other years have been very, very small amount of water.
To see why there's no irrigation here, go 35 miles northwest to Conchas Lake, the depleted reservoir that should be supplying water to the farmers and ranchers around Tucumcari.
And you could see the water line there, the high water line, which is about 43 feet above where we're standing here. That's a lot of water that that we need for irrigation that we don't have right now due to the drought.
For 2 years, there's been no water at all released into this canal that goes to Tucumcari. To do that, the lake level would have to rise about 10 feet. Some farmers still prepare their dry fields hoping for rain, but that hope is slim, and few believe there will be any water in this canal anytime soon. For some, the only way out of this drought could be to sell out.
But it might have got to the point that we'd have to sell the land, and I just can't see doing that. I mean, the cows was hard enough.
Fortunately, Bob and Jane Frost have not had to face that decision.
That it might have come to that if we didn't have the towers.
The towers, 22 wind turbine towers on the land they own up in Cap Rock Ridge. Built 8 years ago by a wind energy developer that offered to lease land from them in exchange for royalties. Each one of the megawatt turbines can produce enough electricity to power 300 average homes. The turbines on their land are just part of those on the Cap Rock wind farm that has 80 turbines generating power for New Mexico, Texas, Oklahoma, and Kansas, and generating income for ranchers leasing their land to the energy company.
They bring in some cash money and comes once a year and you know it's going to be there.
So we look at wind as a new resource that farmers and ranchers can harvest.
Bill Midcap of the Rocky Mountain Farmers Union advises on renewable energy opportunities.
Farmers and ranchers have not enjoyed any benefit from water resources in this area for about 12 years. So they've relied on the wind resource to have income in lieu of income that they had off of livestock or crops. So this is a very important resource that farmers can use to sustain themselves and stay on the land.
There's a growing interest in the wind turbine industry here in a part of the country where there's plenty of wind.
Okay, right now the generator is coming up.
At the North American Wind Research and Training Center in Tucumcari, students from all over the world are trained to maintain and repair turbines, which they believe are a perfect fit for farmers and ranchers.
The farmer or rancher will lease the land required to install the wind turbine. He will continue to use that land for grazing or for growing crops, because the wind turbine is not obtrusive to those functions.
And I believe they're going to be a more important factor as we can get transmission lines and build them.
We're not going to see large wind turbine developments close to cities and towns. It's going to be in rural America. We need folks to work on a national grid that allows us to send these clean electrons to population centers that want this type of clean energy.
There's obvious potential for more wind energy here, with more benefits for other landowners.
It's not only for right now, but for future generations. I think it's something that our kids will have for extra income down the road, too.
Extra income and some insurance against extreme weather in the years ahead. Sure, the eastern indigo snake may look tough. After all, it can grow to 6 or 7 feet, and it's known as the lord of the forest. But don't let those beautiful iridescent scales fool you. This non-venomous reptile is in trouble across the southeast. Here's a look at how some supporters are trying to rescue it. Gary Stryker has our story.
150 years ago, longleaf pine forest like this dominated the coastal plain of the United States, from Texas to Virginia and down through central Florida. This strong heart of pine literally built the Southeast and beyond, seemingly endless timber that was relentlessly clear-cut.
Longleaf pine was virtually eliminated from the Southeast over the last 150 years. So there's less than 0.1% of old growth longleaf pine left on Earth.
Leaning tall pines with gnarly bonsai-shaped limbs frame sunny patches of wiry grass, a habitat that is home to many remarkable animals and an extraordinary variety of plant life.
In just a, you know, 3 by 3 foot, you know, square meter area, you can have upwards of 60 plant species.
So why would they want to set it on fire?
We're trying to generate the kind of fire effects that lightning ignited wildfires would have normally have produced.
Fire is good for the system and is necessary. All these plants that you see out here, the hundreds of plant species associated with the longleaf pine forest, are invigorated by fire.
The longleaf pine forest and plants and animals living within it have adapted to regular fire and the clear open spaces it provides. The eastern indigo snake is one of them.
It's a strikingly beautiful animal. The largest snake in North America. Their scales are covered with a kind of an iridescent sheen that in the right light just is brilliant. They're top predators in this ecosystem. They're different than a lot of other snakes in that they're primarily snake-eating snakes. The indigo snake was listed in the late 70s under the Endangered Species Act as a threatened species, and it is probably extinct in about a third of its range.
In southern Georgia, the Orion Society has set up an indigo snake preserve in prime longleaf habitat. They collect data not only on indigo snakes, but also on another closely linked reptile, the gopher tortoise, whose burrow is almost an ecosystem in itself.
Gopher tortoise needs a burrow to survive, so it digs a series of burrows, and those burrows stay relatively cool in the summer and relatively warm in the winter.
The gopher tortoise is what we see as a keystone species because it provides a habitat for other organisms that they can't really get elsewhere.
The indigo snake requires the gopher tortoise burrows in order to breed and overwinter.
In addition to making sure that indigo snakes have the right habitat and neighbors, the Orion Society has built an unprecedented indigo snake breeding facility in central Florida. There, with the help of Auburn University and other partners, they're raising snakes that will be released into the wild.
Our main goal is to develop a reproductive colony. This one will actually, that's a year old now, will be a breeder 3 years from now.
Doing reintroductions of snakes, there have been very few examples of snakes populations being restored. Oftentimes you can get them to breed, but there's a big problem with getting females to produce viable eggs.
This is a very unique setup.
Building these outdoor enclosures is cutting edge. This is some of the newest approaches to doing this. We really think that by providing them exposure to sunlight and UV especially will help them increase breeding success.
This project has already released indigo snakes into the Konica National Forest for the last 3 years.
So what we're doing here is reintroducing the eastern indigo snake back into Alabama. And it's been missing since 1954. And we're trying to release about 30 snakes per year. And over a period of time, we will be able to build up enough snakes here so that they're self-sustaining and we don't have to put any more out here. With the radio receiver, we can follow these snakes around to see what they're doing. Otherwise, we release snakes and really don't, we don't see them again. They're so elusive, that they can just disappear into the forest and into the landscape. After our first year of releases, we began to see that the snakes were at least attempting or beginning to reproduce in the wild.
Groups like the Orion Society and the Nature Conservancy are dedicated to managing remaining patches of longleaf and protecting all the unique plants and wildlife that call it home.
Okay, so you're working on this upcoming story, and again, it's one I would have liked to have done. We went to a beautiful spot. Tell us about
it. I did. I got to go to Santa Cruz Island. It's off the coast of Southern California, and we got to hang out with this really adorable little island fox that was all fluffy and cute. And then we got to meet these really cool kids who are actually working as interns in the environmental sciences. So all around, good time.
Good, I want to see it.
Definitely.
Well, thanks for watching, and remember, you can catch us anytime at thisamericanland.org. We'd like to hear your comments and your ideas. We'll see you next time.
For more information about this program, visit thisamericanland.org. Funding for This American Land provided by the Weiss Foundation and the Turner Foundation.